Hi, my name is Laura, and I'm here to talk to you about kidney transplant. Transplant is a journey. It's another form of treatment for kidney disease, the treatment that ultimately improves your quality of life. There are two types of donors for kidney transplant. The first type is a deceased donor where you're on the waiting list and you could potentially get a deceased donor off of that list. The second type of donor is the living donor. You could have an unrelated living donor or you could have a related donor. Many people wonder, am I a candidate for transplant? There are a lot of things we will evaluate during your transplant journey. First, either you're on dialysis or your GFR is 20 or less. That means you're nearing that stage of either needing dialysis or a transplant. But there are other things we look at as well during this evaluation process. We want to ensure that you're going to gain quality of life post-transplant. So a few things that we look at that could potentially be barriers for transplant, for example, are malignancy. Say you've had breast cancer in the past. We may want to wait a period of 5 years before we move forward so that we know it's safe and you're going to be successful. If you have coronary artery disease, that's heart disease, or a history of blockages in your heart that have been cleared, we'll want to make sure that those have been treated and it's been resolved so that you can safely move forward. Lung disease is another one, because as you know, we're going to put you under anesthesia. We want to make sure that your lungs are healthy enough to move forward. Bleeding disorders, as you know, we're going to be doing surgery, so we want to make sure there are no issues with bleeding at the time of transplant that may need to be addressed before we move forward. Some of the other ones are psychiatric disease, for example. Doesn't mean you're not a candidate for transplant, but what it means is we need to ensure it's treated so that you have as much support as possible during this journey you're going on. BMI is one that many people ask about. BMI is greater than 45. We don't feel it's safe to move forward because many times there are problems with recovery, problems with your incision healing. So we recommend a BMI of 40 or less to move forward with transplant. However, we do have the option to waitlist you for transplant at a BMI of 40 to 45 and offer a variety of solutions to get to that goal weight, such as an endocrine, which is a medical form of weight loss, or bariatric surgery. Any sort of liver disease, for example, some folks may come forward with a history of liver damage. We'll need to evaluate that to ensure you don't need a kidney liver transplant and not a kidney alone. The other thing is smoking. Smoking does lung damage, and it can also increase your risk of cancer post-transplant. So we'll want to make sure that you're not smoking during that time you're on the waiting list. Let me give you an overview about the process. Very first step in the process is we're going to apply for transplant. When we receive your application, we're going to follow up very quickly to ensure that our financial folks have talked to your insurance to make sure it's approved to move forward. The second part of that process is the actual evaluation, which we're going to get into a little more detail on that in the coming slides. That's where you'll meet with our transplant team, and maybe undergo some testing to ensure you're going to be successful. The next step is selection committee, and that's our team determining if it's safe for you to move forward with transplant or if there's additional testing that might be needed. Then you'll be placed on the wait list. The next step is we'll either see you yearly or talk to you every 6 months to make sure you're ready and you haven't had testing done somewhere else, so we don't need to repeat it in the future. You're called in for transplant, most exciting part, and then you have your transplant surgery and you follow up with us post-transplant. So how do we do this? There's a lot of talk about the one-day evaluation and many patients say, where am I in this process? We have two ways of doing an evaluation based on you and what your status is. For example, the one-day evaluation means you may not have started dialysis yet, or if you've less than 4 years of dialysis time. So we can do your evaluation in 1 day. That means you come in and you meet with the transplant coordinator to get any information you need to move forward with your evaluation. You're gonna see a nephrologist and a social worker and get some labs. And that nephrologist is going to tell you what he thinks in terms of candidacy and what steps need to be taken care of to ensure you're a candidate moving forward for transplant. The second option is what we call readiness testing. We don't tend to test people every year that are not ready for transplant. What we do is we check in on you every 6 months to ensure nothing's changed and you don't need any additional education regarding the process. But once you hit readiness, which means you've been either on dialysis for 4 years or you have chronic kidney disease, but you've been on our list for 4 years, or you've accepted certain types of offers that you'll need to be ready for. That includes the one-day evaluation, but it may include some imaging, some heart testing, some additional labs, or consults to ensure we've completed the entire evaluation based on your history. Once you're on the wait list, there are going to be key things to remember down the road that we'll talk about. Once you're ready for what we call selection committee, your coordinator is going to be talking through this process. They'll let you know when you're done with your evaluation and what to expect in terms of the next step. Your nephrologist will present you at the selection committee. This is multidisciplinary in nature. We have a nephrologist, a social worker, dietitian, surgeons, psychologist, a multitude of individuals that are looking at your case to ensure that no stone has been unturned. This is where the decision regarding candidacy is made. So it could go one of three ways. Candidate for transplant, no further testing needed. At that point, you're going to get a call from the coordinator saying, exciting news, you've been approved. We're going to get you moving forward to listing. The second option is what we call possible candidacy. There's something in that evaluation that a member of the team thinks needs to be further explored. So for example, if you had a stress test and there was some little abnormality that someone on the team thinks needs to be explored, maybe have another test to further evaluate it, you'll get a call from the coordinator saying, we've deferred the decision regarding your candidacy until this is explored, and we're going to get you set up for that testing and bring you back to committee after it's been completed. Third option is transplant's not the best option for you. A lot of times it's based on heart disease or peripheral vascular disease. Heart disease that can't be fixed, or vascular disease that could potentially prevent safe connection for your kidney. If you're not a candidate for transplant right now, you may be a candidate in the future, so we're going to give you those tools to resolve those issues if it's possible, so you can reapply at a later date. At that time, too, we're going to give you the decision to transfer your waiting time. If you're listed at another center, for example, you may want to transfer your time to UT Southwestern. Once you're placed on the list, there are really three big pieces of data we need to have to move forward with listing. First is your blood type. We need two blood types on two separate occasions to ensure that's really the correct blood type for you. The second is tissue typing. Tissue typing is, I like to define it as fruits. For example, when they draw your blood, they're going to identify six fruits unique to you. Say you have a banana, an apple, a pineapple, a grape, a pear, and a mango. We're going to plug those fruits into the system. So when a donor becomes available, they match those fruits. It's just another option for determining how well you match. You can get a kidney that none of the fruits match, and your outcome's still going to be good. But it's just another piece of data that can be utilized in getting you a good kidney. The third piece of data is what we call a PRA. PRA is kind of complicated. It is called panel-reactive antibodies. I like to give the analogy, say you're in your dialysis unit or at your nephrologist office, and they test your blood and they say, you don't have antibodies against hepatitis B. Let's vaccinate you for that. So down the road, if you're exposed to hepatitis B, you have antibodies, defenses, that are going to kick that hepatitis B out. Same concept with PRA. It ranges from 0 to 100. And how you're vaccinated here in theory is, you could have a previous transplant, you gain all of their defenses, or you've had previous pregnancies and gain those defenses, or you've had certain IV infusions that have antibodies in them that could raise that score close to 100. The higher that PRA is, it may be a little bit harder to get the good match for you. However, if it gets so high, the organ bank recognizes that you need priority because it's going to be hard to match. You can list at multiple centers in the same state or even around the nation. The goal is that you don't repeat testing multiple times because your insurance may not pay for it. We will assist you in any way possible to do that. And we will also share information with the primary coordinator at that center. The key points to remember is when you're listed at multiple centers, the center that calls you for transplant will be doing your transplant. So say, for example, you're listed in Ohio. If you get called from Ohio, you'll need to be transplanted in Ohio and follow up there. So listing status, a lot of folks have questions about what's my status on the wait list? Where do I stand on the wait list? Your dialysis time is really critical in determining how long you've been on the wait list and how much qualifying time you have. So say you started dialysis in 2012, but you just came to us in 2020 to be evaluated. You will be credited all the way back to 2012, which means you have 8 years of wait time. You're gonna get to transplant very quickly. The other part of that is average wait times. This is worth considering a living donor. Average wait time is 5 to 7 years. So considering a living donor as an option will get you to transplant even sooner. There are two statuses on the wait list. Active status one means I am active on the wait list and I am ready to receive a kidney offer. Status seven means right now there's a barrier to moving forward safely. It could be you were hospitalized recently. It could be we can't contact you for transplant. Or it could be there could be concerns about adherence to dialysis. That means following your dialysis on a regular basis and making sure you complete the appointments that are needed to ensure a successful transplant. 9 times out of 10, we fix the issue, we reactivate you for transplant, and you're ready to move forward again. Your coordinator will walk you through that when your status changes to let you know if you're on hold, this is what we need to do to get you active and eligible again. So there's some key things we need to remember about being on the wait list. We have to be able to reach you. So if your phone numbers change, your address changes, please call us, because in the middle of the night when they call you, they'll need to have that accurate information. That call can come from anywhere in the nation because we have a service that takes care of those organ offers. So we know we all get a lot of spam calls. Always answer it because you can always hang up because it could potentially be a kidney for you. The other thing too is if your insurance changes, let us know immediately so that we can go to your new insurance and ensure that you're still approved to move forward with transplant. Contact information, if you're hospitalized for some reason, give us a call because we may need to get those records and get an issue resolved before we can move forward. Think about it this way. We can't contact you. We can't transplant you. We are also available 24 hours a day. So if an issue arises after hours, you can definitely give us a call.